All right, what's going on, everyone, and happy new year. So in this video, what I want to do is go through the top five mistakes that I see people making with their diet, especially now here in the new year, as many people are trying to lose fat, build muscle, and get healthier. And even though I do see these things as mistakes, anyone who's committed to doing their best to improve their body composition does deserve some credit. So if you found any of these things working for you, then that's totally fine. So with that out of the way, let's dig into the first common diet mistake, which is simply focusing far too much on the little details. And this is what we'd call putting the cart before the horse, or majoring in the minors. Now, because there is so much information out there on nutrition, and every voice on this topic tends to try to spin their info in some unique way, people tend to start focusing on the minor details that aren't actually moving the needle much when it comes to losing fat or building muscle. For example, many people will switch to organic produce, thinking it's going to help them lose more weight or improve their health, whereas in reality, if it makes any difference at all, it's extremely small, especially for the cost. One systematic review published in the Annals of Internal Medicine, looking at over 200 independent studies on organic versus conventional foods, found no evidence that organic food is more nutritious. In fact, out of those 200 plus studies, only one nutrient, phosphorus, was superior in organic foods, and even that effect went away when the researchers removed a single study from their analysis. Granted, many people choose organic because they think it's safer, but this is far from agreed upon as well. So while there could be some benefits, it's far from the first thing people should turn to when making a change to their diet, and often can distract from what really matters, which we'll get to. Now, another example of this is the glycemic index. Not many people realize that glycemic index values only apply when foods are eaten on their own. Even though white rice is considered a high glycemic carb source, when is the last time you ate a plate of white rice on its own? Chances are you'll be combining that rice with a protein source like salmon, and hopefully a vegetable source. In this case, the fat from the salmon and the fiber from the broccoli will slow down the rate of digestion so that the blood sugar spike you'd normally see from the white rice is significantly blunted. So under most circumstances, unless you're a diabetic, you don't really need to worry about the glycemic index too much. Now, that isn't to say the glycemic index is totally useless. For example, I try to prioritize low glycemic carb sources in a low-fat pre-workout meal, but it still occupies way too much of the limelight for people trying to lose fat or get healthier, and can once again distract from the things that really matter. I also think meal timing hogs too much of the spotlight. Originally, people used to think that you had to eat 6 meals a day to stoke the metabolic furnace, but that turned out to be a complete myth. Now, most people seem to have flipped to the exact opposite stance. Now, fasting is the key, and you should only eat 1 or 2 meals a day. However, emerging evidence suggests that the benefits here just come down to daily caloric intake for the most part. So in my opinion, how many meals you should eat per day should be mostly up to personal preference and whatever's going to allow you to adhere to your caloric targets better overall. Assuming your goal is fat loss, intermittent fasting might help you stick to your diet better, whereas eating more meals per day might help someone else stick to theirs better. Ultimately, because total daily caloric intake and total daily protein intake are going to drive 90%+ of your results when it comes to body composition, especially as a beginner, these details usually are the things that can either be dictated by your schedule or just ignored, depending on how much you want to squeeze out those 1 to 2 percentage points of optimization. Now, the second mistake many people make is thinking in black and white or good and bad terms. Now, this is so common in the mainstream media, where you see the target shifting from fats being bad to carbs being bad to carbs are okay, but sugar is bad. Whereas in reality, there are so many shades of gray to these blanket statements. And all of these things can be bad if they're leading to excessive fat gain or if they're displacing other nutrients in the diet, but none of them are really bad in a vacuum. You just need to look at the diet as a whole, and all of these common culprits can have a place in a healthy diet. So when it comes to health, rather than setting up an exclusive diet where you pick things out that you should never eat, I prefer to set up an inclusive diet where you instead focus on prioritizing certain foods and nutrients. So for example, when it comes to health, there are a few guiding principles that you can set up. First, you want to aim for at least 3 to 4 servings of vegetables and 2 servings of fruit per day. Second, you want to rotate your sources of fruits and vegetables and eat foods of different colors. You should also try to eat fatty fish once or twice a week, and overall try to stick to a whole foods, minimally processed diet 80 to 90% of the time. Then for the other 10 to 20% of calories, you can eat what you enjoy, which is going to improve your adherence over time without derailing your progress. Okay, so number 3 is making sudden, drastic changes to your diet. This is really common in the new year when motivation is high and people want to get their results right away. So you'll see some people slashing their calories in half, trying to lose 20 to 30 pounds in a month, And by the same token, you'll see some people who want to build muscle load up on weight gainer shakes and eat as many calories as they can stomach. And while I love the motivation, generally it is more effective over the long term to go with a more moderate and sustainable approach. So when cutting, a slower rate of weight loss is going to preserve muscle mass so much better, meaning if you crash diet on very low calories, you may lose more weight, especially in the short term, but you also risk losing a larger proportion of that weight from muscle. And in my coaching experience, you also run a greater risk of rebounding after you reach your goal weight. Most people just end up feeling so deprived after a crash diet that they end up gaining all the weight back anyway. So when it comes to both cutting and bulking, a more gradual approach is usually more effective. For fat loss, I generally recommend a deficit no bigger than 25%. As a rough ballpark, losing about 1% of your body weight per week will maximize fat loss while minimizing muscle loss. So if you weigh 200 pounds, losing about 2 pounds per week is going to make sure you preserve as much muscle as possible while losing fat. Granted, this does depend on your starting level of body fat, and I really like this figure from Revive Stronger, where you can see that the more body fat you have, the more you can get away with faster rates of weight loss without risking as much muscle loss. Now, when it comes to gaining, it really depends on how experienced you are. Because you'll have a greater capacity to build muscle as a beginner, you can generally get away with bigger caloric surpluses. So for a new lifter with the primary goal of building lean mass, I recommend starting at about 25% above maintenance. Now, in the case of so-called hard gainers, your metabolism might adapt upward so aggressively that you need to just bump calories way higher than what the math would show to actually gain weight. Now, but regardless, for beginners, aiming to gain 1 to 1.5% of your body weight per month is a good target to maximize muscle gain while avoiding fat gain. And as you get more and more advanced, you'll want to scale those numbers back. So while these guidelines won't capture every scenario, they should hopefully give you some better footing than just slashing your calories in half or eating as much as possible. All right, mistake number four is relying on nutrition documentaries as a legitimate source of information. Now, I can't say every nutrition documentary ever made is bad, but I've seen all the popular ones, and I haven't seen one yet that I'd actually recommend. And the reason for this is that they're generally created by producers that already have an idea in mind that they then try to prove to you. And in nutrition, this is especially easy to do because there are so many divergent findings in the scientific literature. So any documentarian could just go searching for studies that support their position and then piece it together into a narrative that feels very convincing to the viewer. You can contrast this with actual scientific literature, where the goal isn't to prove any given position, but rather to collect evidence and draw conclusions based on whatever the data says, whether it supports your bias or not. Also, just because something is on television or on Netflix or even has a bunch of views on YouTube doesn't mean it's reliable. Generally, this sort of reach just comes from whether or not the content is emotionally appealing enough to attract a broad audience, and that tends to come with a lot of bias. So rather than turning to Netflix, I'd recommend reading actual research reviews. Now, these aren't free, but they are affordable for what you get, and I'll just put a table up here of the ones that I personally subscribe to, and I'll link them down below as well. And what you'll get from these is information coming directly from the scientific literature as a whole, rather than one producer's point of view that's often twisted to fit a narrative. Okay, and the final mistake is focusing too much on supplements. Now, that isn't to say all supplements don't work, it's just that we should be putting them at the very tip of the iceberg, but most people who want to lose weight or build muscle turn to supplements as a first course of action. Now, as a beginner, I think the only supplement I'd strongly recommend is whey protein powder, simply because getting in enough protein from whole food sources alone is often pretty tough. Also, if you're looking for a little extra edge, you can use creatine and caffeine, as they're both well supported by a solid body of science. But beyond those, the evidence supporting supplementation starts to get much more mixed, and in my opinion, should apply to more intermediate to advanced level trainees looking to squeeze out every little bit of progress that they can. And in my nutrition guide, I organize supplements into tiers of priority, and I'll put that up here as well in case you guys are curious which supplements I recommend over others. So that's it for this one, guys. If you're interested in learning more about my full approach to nutrition, I recommend checking out my nutrition guide over at jeffnipper.com. Where researcher Chris Barakat and I explain exactly how to set up your calories, macros, and every other element of your diet, depending on what your main goal is, whether it's to lose fat, build muscle, or do both at the same time. And for the new year, I'm offering the nutrition guide at 20% off with the purchase of any training program on my website, including my new full body routine. So I'll put a link to the nutrition guide over here next to my head if you guys would like to check it out. Don't forget to leave me a thumbs up if you enjoyed the video, subscribe if you haven't already, and I'll see you guys all here in the next one.